Thank you. Dominus vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Oremus. Omnipotens et omnipotens Deus, qui in corde beati Mariae Virginis Dei Spiritus Sancti hac peccatum perdonaste, concede Christus, Deus de miraculari cordis dimensionem, devote vermente recommendus de quodum cordium vivere veniamus, gravid ausum Iesum Christum tuum, dignitate eustem Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum. Lexi libri salapi en CA. Ego quasi nidi fregati suae tabno adores et flores mei putus honoris et honoris estatis. Ego magi potor exiones et timores et tunes et sante spedi. In me gratia omnis vie et veritatis. In me omnis spes vitae et virtutis. Tanti te ad me omnis vicum citis me et gestionis meis in paemini. Spiritus anum meus super male ducis, veritas super male et favum. Memoria mea gestiones seculorum, vivit me adux exuriet, et qui vivunt me adux sitiet. Qui audit me non confundetur, et qui operantur in me non peccabunt. Qui elugidat me, vitam eternum habebunt. Dominus vobiscum. Sequentia Sancti Evangelii secundum Ioannem.
Gloria tibi, Domine.
Tempore, stab on ipsa crucem Jesu, mater eius, asura matis eius, mani clefe, and mania magdalene. Comitis erago Jesus, materem, lucidum stantam quem diligebat, vici mate sue, mulier, ecce filius tuus. Deone dici discipulo, ecce mater tua. Et ex illa corora, ecce eum discipulus in sua. Son, Holy Ghost, Amen. Maria, God, supply our dogmas, take them. Benedicta, Tonibus. And Benedictus, Fructus, Ventris, Tu, Jesus. Please be seated. On this first Saturday of November, we'll continue our series by explaining the ceremonies of the Holy Sacrifice of the Mass. Part 14, the Lavabo. The sign of the cross is made over the oblation, and the priest with hands joined goes to the epistle side of the altar. Outside the edge of the altar, he washes the thumb and forefinger of both hands, and then dries them, reciting at the same time the psalm, and beginning with the word Lavabo. Near the time of the great mystery occurs the Lavabo, a second ceremony of purification. Looking back over the first part of the Mass, we can recall how the Confiteor was recited. That was to purify ourselves, to make our heart clean by sincere detestation of every kind of sin. Nothing can be more important than our heart be crystal clear, filled with sunlight, cleansed and adorned for the coming of Christ. The washing of the hands means just that. We want our Lord to wash us yet more from our iniquity and cleanse us from our sins. Psalm 1, verse 4. Not once, but often should we make the effort to purify ourselves. Here then, in the second part of the Mass, is the washing of hands, an important external act expressing the cleansing of the soul from every stain. If we take the point of view of the East, we will readily understand this action of the Mass. Water signified purity, washing the hands. A figure taken from the practice of the priests was declarative of cleanliness. In Eastern lands, the dust and sand blown by the winds make washing a frequent process. There are many lavations. Especially was this practice of washing connected with the services of the temple in Jerusalem. There were lavers, big bronze bowls before the tabernacle in which the priests washed their hands and feet before offering sacrifice. Exodus chapter 30, 18 to 21 explains that. And when a leper was brought back to health, running water was required to be used. Or again, there was the washing of hands as a protestation of innocence. If a murder was committed in ancient Israel and the murderer was unknown, the elders met for the oath of purgation. And this is what the oath said, quote, "And all the elders of that city that are next to the slain man shall wash their hands over the heifer that is beheaded in the valley. And they shall answer and say, our hands have not shed this blood, neither have our eyes seen it." End of quote. We can read the old law in Deuteronomy, chapter 21, verses 1 to 8, speaking for God, the prophet Ezekiel declared, quote, "And I will pour upon you clean water, and you shall be cleansed from all your filthiness, and I will cleanse you from all your idols, and I will give you a new heart, and put a new spirit within you, and I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit in the midst of you, and I will cause you to walk in my commandments, and to keep my judgments, and do them." Ezekiel 36, verses 25 to 27. Enough has been said to show that water in the old law symbolizes the means of moral cleansing. It was the same in the new. Of the baptismal cleansing of the soul, Our Lord Jesus Christ said, in John chapter 3, verse 5, unless a man be born again of water and the Holy Ghost, and so on. Observe, too, how beautifully St. Paul speaks of Christ's love for his church. Quote, he delivered himself up for it, that he might sanctify it, cleansing it by the labor of water in the word of life, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. Ephesians 5, verses 25 to 27. Surely we can see why the act of washing has a place in the Mass. It is indicative of innocence, of an ardent desire to meet our Lord with a clean conscience and with a pure soul. Each one should strive to secure interiorly what is symbolized by the external action of the priest. Our Lord is presently to present us to his Heavenly Father. Obviously, therefore, a pure state of soul is what we need. Otherwise, how are we going to draw near with a true heart in fullness of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with clean water? Quotation from Hebrews 10:22. The lavabo signifies that we should be free from every defilement of sin. It is par excellence, the psalm of innocence. By it, both priests and people beg God for freedom from sin. The priest stands before God's altar in close relation to Jesus Christ. The people are to be partakers in the sacrifice. Their inmost nature should turn toward God and to Him alone. They should be guileless. Each should say, quote, I carry my soul in my hands and wash it and see that it is clean, ready to offer to the Eternal Father a pure and wholesome sacrifice of my very self. That wish, that hope, that prayer finds fitting expression in the words, acts, and movements of the lavabo. Outside the edge of the altar, the priest washes and dries his fingers, reciting even as he cleanses and dries them the Psalm 25, the following verses. I will wash my hands among the innocent and will compass thine altar, O Lord, that I may hear the voice of thy praise and tell of all thy wondrous works. I have loved, O Lord, the beauty of thy house and the place where thy glory dwelleth. Take not away my soul, O God, with the wicked, nor my life with men of blood, in whose hands are iniquities, their right hand is filled with gifts. But as for me, I walked in my innocence, redeem me and have mercy on me. My foot hath stood in the direct way, and in the churches I will bless thee, O Lord. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as was in the beginning, as never shall be, world without end. Amen. Such, then, is the exquisite prayer of the washing of hands, the lavabo. The rapid review given of the use and significance of washings makes sufficiently clear the meaning of this psalm. But there's still more. There's still more worth knowing about this subject. A rich historical background sets off the beautiful ceremony of the lavabo. We have seen how scrupulously careful the Jews were in their many washings, and how concerned they were with cleanliness when they went to religious worship. It will help to see other instances of this. They will shed more light on the Mass. For example, amongst God's sermons of old, David did not dare to go to the sacred festival because he was not clean at that time. Jeremiah was, quote, restrained, probably by uncleanness, and could not go into the temple, as mentioned in Jeremiah 36, verse 5. Isaiah quailed at the consciousness of his unworthiness, at the thought that he had dared to cross the threshold of the temple. Then said he, quote, "Woe is me, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people that hath unclean lips, and I have seen with my eyes the King, the Lord of hosts." Similarly, in the New Testament, in New Testament times, when our Lord came, the custom of washing frequently, especially before meals, was still in vogue. This is referred to in the account of the marriage feast of Cana, for example. There were 6 stone water pots for the water of purification, which our Lord later turned into wine. St. John chapter 2, verse 6. On the occasion where our Lord entered the house of Simon, the Pharisee, the host did not give him water to bathe his feet. According to the usages of the East, it was customary for the master of the house, when receiving guests, to provide them with water to wash their feet. Usually, this feet washing took place before a banquet, and his absence on this occasion was remarked by Christ when he visited Simon. But Mary Magdalene poured precious ointment on our Lord's feet, and he took occasion to chide the Pharisee while he praised the faith of the repentant sinner Mary Magdalene, as mentioned in St. Luke chapter 7, verse 44. Another example, and this is very important, at the Last Supper, our Lord himself rose and washed the feet of his disciples in order to teach them humility. Quote from St. John 13, 1-17. "I am among you as he that serveth." Now it was the function of a slave to wash the feet of the guests. That is why St. Peter grew indignant and protested, but the divine master gently rebuked him. Quote, "If I wash thee not, thou shalt have no part with me." This is plainly a parable of things spiritual. Our Lord Jesus Christ tells Peter how humble he must be if he would have the Spirit of Christ. He must follow not his own way, but the way of his divine master. By staying close to Christ in love, humility, and obedience, the disciples' earthly thoughts will be spiritualized, his earthly aims elevated, and pardon secured for his shortcomings and sins. All this happened, remember, at the Last Supper, where the first Mass was said. The Church never forgets even a single detail or lesson coming from that holiest of evenings, which meant so much for us and for our salvation. Accordingly, in every Mass, there is a washing, not of the feet, but of the hands. It symbolizes the need of forgiveness of sins by repentance and prayer. Having voiced our repentance in the Confiteor, we now pray in the lavabo for the complete forgiveness of sins which Christ alone can effect in our souls. How careful should we be to pray, all of us, for we have need of divine help. The lavabo is said when the priest washes his hands over the little basin and the server hands of a towel. Outward appearance here has inward significance. The washing of the hands is to show how pure and clean should be the hands and heart of the priest when he comes to consecrate and receive the Blessed Sacrament. In view of this, the priest says the prayer of the psalmist, who of old stood on God's side and compassed his altar, wished always to wash his hands in innocence and sought to give thanks to God in his house. A few moments ago, the priest begged that the oblation be accepted by God, and he offered it in a spirit of humility and with a contrite heart. But now, above all things, he wants to be innocent. He wishes to wash his hands in innocence, aware all the time that he's moving about in God's presence. Soon he will be offering Christ himself. How important, therefore, to walk in his truth, to lead a good life. How necessary that the heavens hold firm the walls of his innocence, keep unshaken that temple, his soul, that he may stand and offer a worthy sacrifice. What the priest asked for in this psalm prayer, we also need. Unfortunately, we're apt to stray from the right path. The fact is that once we let ourselves drift, there is a spontaneous tendency to sin. Directly we find ourselves in that path, it is time to set ourselves straight with our conscience. Christ is not only the object of our worship, he is also the voice of conscience. And more than that, he is our judge. He is the judge of our eternal destiny. Here in the Mass, we are going to offer ourselves body, soul, mind, life, all that we are, to God. Just as Jesus will offer himself in the hands of the priest, so he will let us offer ourselves with him. What a privilege! Yet we must make ourselves worthy of being presented to God, worthy to be an acceptable people. To purify ourselves from errors or faults by a deep, sincere act of contrition is a condition of hearing Mass well. Then we can pray, quote, "Have mercy on me, O Lord, that I may serve thee in all innocence. This I can do only by great trust in thy power and mercy. Keep my feet in the right way, and allow me in choir to praise thee always with thy saints." Only with a pure heart can one join truly in with the voice of thanksgiving and proclaim all of God's wondrous works, especially the work of redemption. This is what we are here at Mass to do. We can be thanking our Lord in our inmost soul that he once offered himself on the cross to save us, and now that's the same sacrifice to take place before our eyes, so that we may be there and may each receive for our souls some of the great grace he pours out at this solemn moment. Naturally, if our hearts are clean, we shall be full of gratitude. We shall proclaim our loyalty to Christ in the very words of this psalm, of the Lavo. Voicing the spirit of the psalm, we chose God in preference to sinners. We love the altar and the house of God better than worldly things. As Psalm said, "One day in thy house is better than 1,000 in the tents of sinners." But there is still more. There is a promise always to observe a certain line of conduct, infidelity to the teachings of our childhood. As Psalm 25, verses 4 to 5 says, "I have sat not with the counsel of vanity, neither will I go in with the doers of unjust things. I have hated the assembly of the malignant, and with the wicked I will not sit." Now let us mark well the four points. Dangerous points, especially for youth. Vanity, unjust things, things malignant, and things that are wicked. They are one and all pitfalls to be avoided. Having learned that what these dangers are, the duty of us is to avoid them. Undoubtedly, then, our task is to make a clean way for ourselves through all these foes. The Lavabo warns us against them. Sins that soil and profane the house of worship, both our soul and the church, and make it a den of thieves. Therefore, they are to be eliminated. We are to wash ourselves clean of them as we would cleanse our hands of filth. Free our soul from what is foul. Every sin, every moral irregularity prints a stain upon the soul. They are blots which should be entirely cleansed from the soul so that it can say, quote, in simple and pure soul, I come to thee, dear Lord. That is a lesson of the Lavabo. Amen. In the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen. Dominus vobiscum. Oremus.
Thank you.
omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Dominus vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu.
Sursum corda.
Avemus ad Dominum.
Gracias agamus Domino Deo nostro. Vere diminus messe cum salutare, nos tibi semper vivi gratias agere, nobri sancti parum desiderne Deus, et te in orazione beati Maria semper vivis coldare, benedicere et predicare. Quae erugendum tum sancti spiritus om orazione concepi, et veritatis gloria permanente illuminatum mundo effudit, Iesum Christum Dominum nostrum. Per quem estatum tuum laudat angeli, adorat mansiones, tremul potestatem. Caeli junguritas ac beata seraphim, soci exultatione concelebram. Cum quibus a nostras fortes, ut imiti iubes de precamor, supplici confessione dicenter.
Domino.
Omnia saecula saeculorum. Oremus. Receptus autoris moniti, et divina sustone formati, ad eimus dii cere, pater noster, qui es in celi, sanctificetur nomen tuum, adveniat regnum tuum, fiat voluntas tuum, sicut in celo et in terra, panem nostrum quotidianum da nobis hodie, et in nobis debita nostra, sicut et nos dimittimus debitoribus nostris, et ne nos inducas in temptationem. Omnia saecula saeculorum. Pax Domini, sit semper vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Thank you.
Dogs and ears. Dogs and ears. Dogs and ears.
Vessel did this, Miss Cosby, so sing Harold. You know, Jed, so I'm so happy. We're spitting out the sword, but we're so busy with Mr. Dollars. And Jay, on your state. And Jay, quick, don't got to move. And all your subdues, the chairman, the taunted digger, the rose on the mail. And all your subdues, the name, the taunted digger, the rose on the mail. And all your subdues, the interest mail, the taunted digger, the rose on the mail.
Oh.
Dominus vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Ora emus. Divinus capillaris de omnes in generam. Gestione quis altari cores memoriam generam edimus presentibus reclus de gracti adherent super gaudi consequamur per omnia semi esu presidium tuo quique voluntate spiritu sancti deus per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Dominus vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
God vos omnipotens Deus. Pater et Filius et Spiritus Sanctus.
Amen.